Good day to all of you, and welcome to my second lecture on the fifth module of Material Science. I'm Dr. Vincent Krasta, professor from the Department of Physics, St. Joseph Engineering College, Mangalore. So let us just recap what has been learned in the first topic. In the lecture one that I dealt with the classical free electron theory, and their assumptions. And we also learned about the failures of the classical free electron theory, why the classical free electron theory failed based on the temperature dependence and the electron concentration. And hence the new theory was introduced by a great physicist, Sommerfeld, and that theory is the quantum free electron theory. Let us look into, based on that approach, how we are able to form a given band in a given atom. So let us try to understand part by part. So what I do is that I will try to take an atom. So when I'm going to take an atom, the atom has got the various energy levels. So we have the ground state energy level. This is the ground state energy level. And this is the excited energy level. Like that, we have got various other energy levels also. So in an atom, the electrons, atoms are generally in the ground state. And when this atom is being given certain amount of energy, naturally electrons are being excited and they will be ionized only and only when if the electrons are being given sufficient energy. Now this is for one atom. Now suppose one more atom is being brought closer to it. What exactly going to happen? When the second atom is going to be brought, the energy levels of each level is going to split. We can very clearly see that there are two energy levels are going to split here. Every energy levels are going to be splitting into two. So there is splitting of the energy levels are going to take place. And every energy you can see, it is a discrete because they have got a very, very specific energy. Very specific energy. But classically, it doesn't explain this splitting of energy levels. Where classically it says that the energy levels are continuous. So that is the reason that electrons are able to move from one electron or one atom to the other atom. But here, every energy level is going to be discrete. Imagine if there are large number of atoms that have been brought closer, then all these energy levels are going to split into n number of energy levels. So the total number of energy levels are based on the number of atoms that have been brought closer. Likewise, in the case of a bulk material, you can see that these energy levels are been splitting into n such energy levels and they are going to form the band. And this is what exactly called as a formation of the band when the atoms are brought closer to each other. And every one energy that you can see in the band, every one energy is a discrete energy here. There is no continuous energy, it is a discrete energy. And we are trying to fill the electrons. We are trying to fill the electrons. The electrons have been filled from the lowest band. And if the electrons are totally filled, we call it as the full band. Or it is also called as a bound band. This is also called as the bound band. Then we try to fill the electrons in the next and the next like this. Imagine in the topmost or what we call as outermost band, if the electrons could be partially or maybe fully filled, that band is what is been named as a valence band. And the band which is above than that, which is totally empty, and that is called as a conduction band. And the, all the bands which are above than the conduction band are once again empty. But at the same time, you find a small gap between this valence band as well as the conduction band, and that is what we call as a forbidden energy gap, or simply called as a band gap. Therefore, in every kind of material, whether it is a metal or a semiconductor or an insulator, the filling of the electrons is going to take place in the bands based on the Pauli's exclusion principle, where you go on filling the electrons from the lower band, where if it is completely filled, it becomes a bound band. Then the next. The outermost band where the electrons are either completely filled or maybe partially filled is what is called as a valence band. And the band which is just above than that is what we call as a conduction band. One thing that I'll try to tell you, that for any material to conduct, electrons must be found in the conduction band. Only if you see the electrons in the conduction band, then only there is conductivity. Therefore, the question is this, whether there are electrons in the conduction band at zero temperature may not be. But in case there are electrons in the conduction band, they are able to conduct from one corner to the other corner, and hence there is a current in the material. And based on this, we can see the materials are being divided. This is how exactly the classification of the materials are being done. The first kind of material, that is nothing but is a conductor. What you can see? In this, you see a valence band here. This is the valence band and this is the conduction band. And they are going to overlap. You can see there is an overlap. Hence, the energy gap between them is going to be equal to zero. Energy gap is going to be equal to zero. There is no energy gap at all. Not only that, even at absolute zero Kelvin, you find some of the electrons at the topmost band of the valence band are being found at the bottommost of the conduction band. I repeat, even at absolute zero Kelvin, there are few electrons of the valence band are found in the conduction band, and there is a reason that a conductor conducts electricity even at zero Kelvin. So the conductors are going to conduct the electricity because you find electrons in the conduction band. That is the first thing. Take the second, that is an insulator. What do you find there? We have a valence band here and we have a conduction band, and you can see there is a large energy gap. There is a large energy gap where the energy gap is more than or around 5 electron volts. So any given material which has got an energy greater than 3 electron volts are what we call as insulators. And you know, insulators are bad conductors. They do not conduct the electricity even at higher temperature. Why? Because of such a large band, even if there is an increase in the temperature, these electrons are not able to jump to the conduction band. They are not at all able to jump to the conduction band. They fail to jump to the conduction band because of the larger energy gap. Hence, an insulator doesn't conduct the electricity. Come to the third, that is the semiconductor. What you find in the case of semiconductor? In the case of a semiconductor, there is a narrow band gap. A band gap which is lesser than around 3 electron volts, then we call it as a semiconductor. I can give various examples. Silicon is one of the best semiconductor material where the energy gap is 1.1 electron volt. Germanium is the second semiconductor where its energy gap is around 0.67 electron volts. So you can see there is a small energy gap at lower temperature. There are only electrons in the valence band and there are no electrons in the conduction band. But as you increase the temperature, the electrons are able to jump from the lower band to the higher band, that is the valence to the conduction band. Hence, the conduction of the electron that is going to take place. Therefore, in the case of semiconductor, the conductivity entirely depends on the temperature. More and more is the temperature, there is more and more conduction is going to take place. But that is not true in the case of a conductor or maybe in the case of an insulator. Therefore, let us try to see what are exactly the permitted energy levels for any given material. See, even if a metal or a conductor or a solid material, it has only permitted energy levels, which are in terms of bands. You can see in the left side, we have a valence band, we have a conduction band, and they are going to overlap. And there are various number of energy levels that you try to see. There is a overlapping of the energy level that is going to take place as the energy increases. And this energy is going to spread over the entire range of few electron volts. From the lower till the higher, it is going to spread over around few electron volts. And the energy values appear to be virtually continuous over the entire band spread. That means you can see very clearly in the diagram. As you go up, the energy levels are going to become so closer as if they look virtually continuous, but they are not really continuous. They are very discrete. Therefore, the question is this, how many number of energy levels are there? And that has been explained or defined by a term called density of states. So we let us look into a valence band. This is a valence band. Now in this valence band, there are various number of energy levels from the bottom till the top, you can see here. Now if I'm going to take a small arbitrary energy gap, that is E and E plus D, where D is exactly the difference of this energy. T is simply nothing but it is a difference of this energy. The question is that how many number of energy levels are there within this energy? So the number of available energy states per unit energy interval in the band associated with the material of unit volume is what called as the density of states. So the density of state can be defined as the number of available energy states per unit energy interval in the band associated with the material per unit volume, and it has been represented as G of E. Now I have given a small energy gap E and E plus D in the diagram. You can find out how many number of energy levels are there. Suppose if the same gap is being kept between here, whether the number of energy levels are going to be the same? No, the number of energy levels are not really going to be the same. So one thing that you can see, the number of energy levels at the bottom are less, and as you go up, the number of energy levels are goes on increases and increases and increases. Therefore, we are easily able to express this density of states in terms of a derived equation named G of E D, called as the density of states. It is given by the equation 8 into root 2 into pi into m to the power 3 by 2 divided by h cube into square root of E into dE, where 8 root 2 pi m to the power 3 by 2 by h cube is a constant, into square root of E, where E is nothing but it is the energy of a electron, an arbitrary electron, into dE, where D is exactly the small energy gap. And from this equation, it is made very clear that the energy levels are not equally spaced. At the bottom, you see the energy levels are less. But as you go up, the energy levels are going to become closer. Therefore, they are exponential increases. And that is what the graph that explains here. The energy levels initially less, but the energy levels are exponentially increases like this. This is how the energy levels are going to increase. So the question is this, how many such number of energy levels are there in any given material? See, a metal having n free electrons, there are n allowed energy levels. It has got n atoms. Imagine the case of copper. There are n number of atoms are there. There are n number of electrons are there, because every one atom is going to contribute one electron. Naturally, there are n allowed energy levels are there. Now, these all energy levels are quantized. You can see very clearly in the diagram that, you know, every one energy level is discrete, because even though it is going to spread from bottom till the top, but it is a quantized energy. And here what we do is that we try to fill these electrons in accordance with the Pauli's exclusion principle. So where you are able to accommodate a maximum amount of electrons which are not identical. So you go on filling the electrons from the bottom. So we are going to fill the electron from the bottom. We have n number of electrons are there. There are n number of electrons are there. There are n number of energy levels are there. Now since every one energy level has got two electrons, so only n by 2 number of energy levels are being occupied. Therefore, you can see all the energy levels below are being occupied. Therefore, they are called as the filled energy levels. And all the energy levels above are not filled. They are called as the vacant energy levels. Okay. Now, you can see as you fill these electrons, the filling is always taking place from the lowest energy level to the higher energy level. The electron at the lowest most has got least energy. And as you go up, the electron energy goes on increases. And as you go on fill, till n by 2 you are able to fill. And what is this highest occupied energy level? This highest energy occupied level is what we call as a Fermi energy. This is what we call as a Fermi energy. Therefore, Fermi energy is the highest occupied level of the electron at absolute 0 degree. Fermi level is the highest occupied level of the electron at absolute 0 Kelvin. It has been represented by a term called EF, and this is only at absolute zero temperature. This is the Fermi energy. And the Fermi energy is going to take a very, very significant part in the explanation of the conductivity of any given metals. So let us try to see. There are all energy levels are being filled below EF, and all the energy levels above EF are empty. In the diagram, it is very clear. In each energy level, there are only two electrons. Because there are n number of energy levels were there, out of which only n by 2 of them are being occupied by the electrons. And remaining n by 2 are unoccupied. So let us look into what is the distribution. Now, this distribution was explained Fermi along with a well-known physicist named Dirac. And this statistics is called the Fermi-Dirac statistics. And here, in a metal, there are large number of free electrons are present. And each can possess an energy corresponding to a certain energy state in the valence band. Because every electron is going to possess certain amount of energy. Under thermal equilibrium, all these free electrons acquire energy obeying the Pauli's exclusion principle. And those obeying Pauli's exclusion principle, we call them as Fermi-Dirac statistics. Under thermal equilibrium, free electrons acquire energy obeying Pauli's exclusion principle known as Fermi-Dirac statistics. That means, there are n energy levels, n electrons, n by 2 number of electrons are being, energy levels are being occupied by the electrons. Every energy of the electrons are discrete. No electrons in any energy levels are identical. The electrons are identical with the spin off, but they are indistinguishable particle, as I already mentioned in my previous explanation. Fermi-Dirac statistics permits evaluation of probability of finding the electron occupying the energy levels in a certain energy range. See, we are not at all able to see the electrons. We can only try to find the probability of those electrons, whether these electrons are being occupied in these energy levels or not. So Fermi-Dirac principle or the statistics going to give the evaluation of the probability of finding the electrons in the various energy levels. And the evaluation will be done through a function, and that function is called the Fermi factor. Therefore, at a temperature above zero, electrons just below the Fermi level absorb the thermal energy and they try to occupy the higher empty energy levels. You can very clearly see in the diagram. When I try to increase the temperature, some of the electrons at the bottommost are able to jump levels. They are trying to occupy the higher energy level. Naturally, there is an empty of electrons in the energy levels below the Fermi level. So depletion of the electrons taking place at the bottom, and the electrons are able to jump to the higher energy level. So electrons occupy the energy level far below the Fermi level cannot absorb this energy. Why? Because whenever you try to supply the energy, the bit and the bit thermal energy will be occupied by or absorbed by the electrons only below the Fermi level. An electron to jump from this level to the other level where it requires a very small amount of energy. But the electron at the bottommost level to jump to the higher energy level, it requires a large energy. Hence, this jumping is not going to take place. That is the reason only the electrons just below the Fermi level are able to jump to the higher energy level and able to take part in the conductive process. But the electrons at the far below level will not have any probability of conducting or jumping to the conduction band. That is the reason that all the electrons or all the free electrons are not really taking part in the conduction process. That is one of the biggest failures that we saw in the case of classical mechanics. In the case of classical free electron theory, we observed sigma is proportional to n. That means the one which has got more number of electrons would be a better conductor. But here you can see very clearly that only the electrons which are just below the Fermi level are going to take part in the conductive process because they are able to jump. They require a very small energy to jump to the higher energy level. But electrons at the far below level will not have enough energy to jump to the higher energy level. There is a reason that all the electrons are not able to take part in the conducting process. And this probability was explained through a factor what we call as the Fermi factor. Here we consider all the excitations are random. Every excitation, you can't say that which electron is going to jump. It is a random excitation. But the entire distribution of these electrons is really systematic. That means you can't think that, you know, electrons at the bottommost are able to jump. Only the electrons at the topmost, just below the Fermi level, are able to jump. They are systematically able to. But the excitation is really taking place in a random nature. At thermal equilibrium, if you try to see the probability of thermal occupation of these electrons, Fermi has given an equation that called as Fermi factor, which speaks about the probability of occupation of the electrons in any given energy levels, and that is given by the equation F of E is equal to 1 by E to the power E minus EF divided by KT plus 1. Now here, F of E is nothing but it is the probability of the electrons. E is nothing but it is the arbitrary energy of an electron. That means it can be energy of any electron. EF is exactly the energy of the electron at the Fermi level. That is the highest occupied level of the electron at the 0 Kelvin. K is the Boltzmann constant. T is the absolute temperature plus 1. So F of E is equal to 1 by E to the power E minus EF by KT plus 1 is the equation for the probability of occupation of an electron in any given energy state given by Fermi. And there is a reason that this is named as the Fermi factor. So let us look into how this Fermi factor or the probability varies with respect to temperature. So I'm going to give you three different cases. The first case is that the probability of occupation for an electron when the energy of the electron is lesser than the Fermi energy at absolute 0 Kelvin. So I want to know what is the probability of the electron occupying the energy lesser than the Fermi energy at absolute 0 Kelvin. Take the diagram. So here we have a diagram. Imagine this is at absolute 0 Kelvin. At absolute 0 Kelvin, only the electron till the Fermi level are being occupied. Only till here are being occupied. Okay, only till here are being occupied. All the above energy levels are totally empty. Now, I will try to take the energy of an electron lesser than EF. You try to take any one electron. I will try to take any one electron. Because this electron will have an energy lesser than the Fermi energy. At absolute 0 Kelvin. Is there any probability of finding that electron below the Fermi level? Yes, because every energy levels below the Fermi level are being occupied. So let us look into what could be the probability. So we have a Fermi factor. F of E is equal to 1 by E to the power E minus EF by KT plus 1. Now here E lesser than EF. So E lesser than EF means E minus EF is negative. Here E minus EF is negative. Divided by k into t, t is nothing but 0. Therefore, negative quantity by 0. Exponential to the power minus quantity by 0 plus 1. Anything divided by 0 is infinity, but with the negative quantity. Therefore, e to the power minus infinity plus 1. And e to the power minus infinity is nothing but it is 0. It is going to be 0. Therefore, I can write 1 divided by 0 plus 1. It is going to be 1. Which means to say, there is 100% of probability. That means every energy levels are being occupied at absolute 0 Kelvin below the Fermi level. There are no free energy levels are being present below the Fermi level at absolute 0 Kelvin. Therefore, the Fermi factor very clearly tells that there is probability. The word probability F of E is equal to 1 means there is 100% of probability of finding the electron below the Fermi level. Every one energy level has the electrons. Therefore, you can find the electrons below the Fermi level. Take the second case, the probability of the occupation for an energy E greater than EF at absolute 0 Kelvin. Now, I will try to take the energy greater than EF. So, I will try to take an energy here. At absolute 0 Kelvin, only till this level are being occupied. Above the energy level, there are no electrons. So, what is the probability of finding the electron at this point? Supposed to be 0. Let us see. whether we are able to achieve zero probability. So once again, come back to the equation f of e is equal to 1 by e to the power e minus ef by kt plus 1. Now here, e greater than ef. That means e minus ef is a positive quantity. It is a positive quantity. Divided by kt, where t is equal to 0 Kelvin. Therefore, e to the power positive quantity will be 0 plus 1, which is nothing but e to the power plus infinity. You know, e to the power plus infinity is simply nothing but it is infinity only. Therefore, 1 by infinity plus 1. And infinity plus 1 is infinity, and 1 by infinity is going to be equal to 0. Therefore, there is no probability of finding the electrons. That means every energy levels above the Fermi level are unoccupied. Therefore, Fermi factor is very clearly going to explain to you what is the probability of finding an electron below the Fermi level as well as above the Fermi level at absolute 0 Kelvin. There is no probability at all finding the electrons above the Fermi level, but there is 100% of probability finding the electron below the Fermi level. We have a third case. Now, before coming to the third case, so we are able to put this in terms of a graphical representation. Here we are going to take f of e along the y-axis and energy along the x-axis. You see, below the Fermi level, the probability is going to be equal to 1. Wherever you try to take an electron, wherever you try to take an electron, you try to take an electron here or there, is 100% of probability here. Every place the electrons are being occupied. So there is 100% of probability here. 100% of probability here. But what is the probability of finding the electron above the Fermi level? No. Therefore, there is a sudden step function here. So, E less than EF, the probability is going to be equal to 1. And E greater than EF, the probability is going to be equal to 0. That is what the graphical representation here. So, let us try to see the third case. The third case is what will happen at ordinary temperature. That means, if I try to increase the temperature of the given material. When I start increasing the temperature in this kind of material, as it made very clear that the electrons at the far below end are not able to jump to the higher energy level because there are no free vacancies. But the electrons just below the Fermi level are able to jump to the higher energy level. They are able to jump to the higher energy level. Here, their electrons are able to jump to the higher energy level because there are vacancies. So, the electrons at the below the Fermi level are depleting, and these depleted electrons are able to jump to the higher energy level. So whether the probability above the Fermi level, whether it is going to be equal to zero, now it cannot be equal to zero because you find some probability, but that is not 100% probability. Let us look into what is exactly the probability at ordinary temperature. Okay, at the same time, I'll try to find the probability at E is equal to EF, at energy equal to the Fermi energy. And to find out, once again, I'll use the Fermi factor. F of E is equal to 1 by E to the power E minus EF by KT plus 1. But here we try to take E is equal to be equal to EF. But temperature is not equal to 0. Temperature is not equal to 0 now. Okay. Therefore, I can write E to the power E minus EF is 0. Therefore, E to the power 0 plus 1. And E to the power 0 is nothing but is going to be 1. Therefore, 1 plus 1. Therefore, it is going to be half. Which means to say that there is at least 50% of the probability. You can see a minimum of 50% probability of the electrons at the Fermi level. What is the conclusion? The conclusion here is this. As the temperature rises, the electrons just below the Fermi level are able to deplete, and these depleted electrons are able to jump here. They are able to occupy the higher energy levels. They are able to jump to the higher energy levels like this. Suppose the temperature has been raised, if we raise the temperature, there are some more electrons are able to jump here. There are some more electrons are able to jump and they try to occupy the higher energy level. But still, there is a probability. The probability of the electrons at the Fermi level is at least 0.5. That means, which is very clear that you can see only electrons can be depleted. Only electrons can be depleted very closer to the Fermi energy. But electrons far below end cannot be depleted at all. They cannot be depleted at all. Okay, so there is no 100% of conductivity by the electrons. Therefore, only a certain number of electrons are able to jump. Hence, the conclusion very clearly I can give is that Fermi energy is the most probable, or the average energy of the electron across which the energy transition occurs at temperature above 0 degree absolute, which results in the conductivity of metals. Therefore, there is only a probability of the electrons that you find. It is because of only the electrons which are just below the Fermi level and not because of all the electrons that are present in the material. Therefore, this is what the Fermi concept explains, the conductivity of metals. I would like to work out just two problems related to this topic. So let me start working out the first problem. The first problem is, find the temperature at which there is 1% probability that a state with an energy 0.5 electron volt above Fermi energy is occupied. Find the temperature at which there is 1% probability that a state with an energy 0.5 electron volt above Fermi energy is occupied. So what are the data given here? The first data given here is that probability given as 1%. 1% means 1 by 100, which is equal to 0.01. That is the first data given. The second data is, they've said the energy of the electron 0.5 electron above the Fermi energy. So 0.5 electron above the Fermi level means E minus EF is going to be 0.5 electron volts, which is nothing but 0.5 into 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19. If you multiply this factor, it is going to convert the energy in terms of joules. Now let us try to find out what is the temperature. And to find out the temperature, the equation given by Fermi of probability of occupation is F of E is equal to 1 by E to the power E minus EF by KT plus 1. So you can just substitute here. Here F of E is equal to be 0.01, which has already been given there. 1 divided by E to the power 0.5 into 1.6 in terms of minus 19 coulomb, that is E minus EF together, divided by K. K is the Boltzmann constant, 1.38 into 10 to the power minus 23, into T, where T I require to calculate, and this plus 1 is a separate factor. So if you do all the calculation except T here, we'll get the equation 1 by E to the power 5797 divided by T plus 1. So you try to rearrange. You try to find the reciprocal of the above equation, 1 divided by 0.01, which is equal to E to the power 5797 by T plus 1. Now, E to the power 5797 by temperature is equal to 1 by 0.01 minus 1, which is nothing but 100 minus 1 equal to 99. So you try to take the natural logarithms to the base E on both sides. So if you try to take, the exponential term gets cancelled. So remaining factor is 5797 divided by T, which is equal to ln of 99, which is equal to 4.9595. Or the temperature has been given by 1261.6 Kelvin. Therefore, at 1261 Kelvin, you find 1% probability of the electron above the Fermi level. That means, to make the electrons to jump to the higher energy level, you require to have a very large temperature. So this is all about the first problem. Coming to the second problem. Calculate the probability of an electron occupying an energy level 0.02 electron volt above the Fermi level at 200 Kelvin and 400 Kelvin. So there are two cases. Here we have to calculate the probability of the electrons. Temperature has been given. Okay. And once again, the energy level 0.02 electron volt above the Fermi level. So what are the data given? Since the energy is above, E minus EF is equal to be 0.02, which is in terms of electron volts, convert in terms of joules by multiplying 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19. Then the probability of occupation f of e is equal to 1 by e to the power e minus e f by kt plus 1. So by substituting for the first case, the evaluation for 200 Kelvin. So f of e is equal to 1 by e to the power e minus e f is 0.02 into 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 divided by 1.38 into 10 to the power minus 23 into 200 plus 1. That gives you 1 by e to the power 1.1594 plus 1, which is equal to 1 by 3.188 plus 1, which is equal to 0.24. It means to say that 24% energy levels are being occupied by the electron at 200 Kelvin. 24%. Okay. The second part of the problem is to evaluate the probability at 400 Kelvin. The probability of occupation f of e, once again given by the Fermi factor, f of e is equal to 1 by e to the power e minus e f by kt plus 1. Here f of e is equal to 1 by e to the power 0.02 into 10 into 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 divided by 1.38 into 10 to the power minus 23 into 400 plus 1. And if you solve this, it is going to give you 1 by e to the power 0.5797 plus 1, which is equal to 1 by 1.7855 plus 1, which is equal to 0.36, where 36 is the probability. 36% is the probability. So this is the occupation of the electrons of the Fermi level at 400 Kelvin. Thank you very much.